Welcome to Kingston Springs United Methodist Church. We are so glad you are joining us today for worship. If you are online, there is the order of worship on our church website. It's ksumc.org. It has the hymn lyrics on it, as well as responsive reading so that you can join along with us today. We will also be receiving Holy Communion later in the service, so if you want to receive that with us, you will want to have a piece of bread or cracker and juice or water. We have just a few announcements this morning. Our Wednesday night dinners will resume on September the 1st, and we are going to do it tailgate style. So it will be able to eat safely outside instead of being inside, and we'll just, you can bring a lawn chair. There's picnic tables back there, and we'll just set up back there and tailgate together. You can, you'll be able to get it to go too if you don't want to eat outside. If you'd rather eat at home, you can get yours to go. We'll have registration every week, so that we'll know how much food to get. So it should be a fun time together. Also, we are thankful for Tanner and Alyssa, our nursery care providers, and Dominic wanted to join us this morning, so we'll see how that goes. We are in need of a list of volunteers that they can call on when they are unable to be here on a Sunday. So if you would like to be on that volunteer list, just let me know and I can add you to that. Are there any other announcements today? All right, let us now take a deep breath together. Breathe out. Let's allow the Holy Spirit to enter our minds, our hearts. Let us bring all that we are, all that we are supposed to do this week to worship, and let us prepare our hearts and our minds to worship our Lord and Savior as the prelude is played.
Thank you. Please stand as you're able and join me in the call to worship. Your responses are printed in bold in your order of worship. Did you hear about Christ?
Yes, we heard of the truth that is in Jesus.
Were you taught how to live?
Yes, we were taught to turn away from old habits and lies.
Do you want to be remade?
Yes, we want to be more like God.
We want to know what is right and do what is right.
We live a life of love.
Yes, we refuse to grumble or gossip. We won't be catty or harsh.
We will be kind and caring as best we can.
We will forgive as we have been forgiven.
Will you copy Christ?
Yes, because he loved us. First, he gave himself up for us.
Please remain standing as we sing hymn number 399, Take My Life and Let It Be.
Right.
every week we have the great privilege to share our joys and concerns with each other and to lift them up to God in prayer. So as we begin to share our joys today, I want to start by thanking all of our teachers and school staff and school employees for all of their work that they will do this school year. They are beginning a new school year again during a pandemic. So I am just so thankful for all their hard work. And we will pray a blessing over our teachers and our students at the end of the service. But I just want to just be thankful for all our school staff. Any other good things to share?
Well, I just want to share the joy of how wonderful the choir sounded with their mask on. I know.
We are very grateful for our choir who are masked and still sing very well. Jenny's mother-in-law had a successful surgery and is praying for a good recovery. Any other good things to share? Yeah, Rhea?
I don't have another place to live. I've been skinned.
Hey, Evan has a home.
A second home,
that's right. He always has a home, but a second home. Do we have concerns to lift up today? Yeah, Jamie?
My Aunt Marie Swallow recently diagnosed with cancer, and they've already sent her home to hospice, so they don't expect her to last very long. Mm-hmm. This is one of my mother's sisters.
So that's Jamie's aunt, one of her mother's sisters, was on hospice. Yeah, Christy?
The Hyatt family, Mark Hyatt, passed away this last week.
Yeah, we need to remember family of Mark Hyatt, who passed away last week. And for those of you who don't know, he is the son of Jane Hyatt, Mama Jane, as she's known. She was a longtime member here, very active. And so please remember the Hyatt family.
My sister has COVID right now, so she can
see her. Cherie's sister has COVID, so I need to remember. Any other concerns to lift up today? Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Let us pray. God of life, we are thankful to be in your presence today and in the presence of each other. We are grateful for the good gifts that you give us, the gift of love, the gifts of forgiveness, the gift of grace, the gift of each other. Thank you for successful surgeries, for good medical reports, for healing. God, while we are thankful for these good gifts that you give us, you know that there are people and situations that weigh heavy on our hearts and our minds. And we lift those up to you today. We pray for those who are mourning the loss of loved ones, particularly the Hyatt family. We pray for those who are sick today, for those who are struggling with COVID. We know that there are still millions of people around the world who are sick, and we pray your healing. And we pray that there will be an end to this pandemic, that we will not have to start another school year next year in the middle of a pandemic. We pray for those who are recovering from surgery, those who are awaiting test results from procedures. God, we ask that you would
make your presence known in their lives as they recover and as they wait. We pray for all those who are hungry today, those who are without homes. God, may we not ever forget them. May we never forget to pray for them and help them in the best way that we can. God, we pray for those who are suffering today in spirit, those who are feeling down and hopeless. Would you lift them up? May they see the light, even if it's only glimpses. And continue to form us and to shape us into the people that you have called us to be. People who live in your love to share your good news and your justice in the world. We'll give you all the thanks and praise, for you are good and faithful. It's in Christ's name we pray. Amen. Now I invite all the children down front to join me for the children's message. Push
people.
Yeah, treat others as you would want to be treated. Yeah, so there are lots of things that your teacher is probably going to tell you this first couple of days of class that as members of the class that you need to do so that the whole class can learn and grow and be a safe place for everybody. Well, that's what Paul says to the church at Ephesus, to the Ephesians. He, in the part of his letter that he writes to them, which we've been talking about his letter for a couple weeks, he tells them that you are part of God's family. And as a part of God's family, there are things that we need to do. One of them, I've got some things here, is to tell the truth. So he says that as members of God's family, we should tell the truth because when we lie to each other, we begin not to trust each other. And trust is important to be part of God's family. So tell the truth. Second one is anger. He says, it's okay to be angry, but it's what we do with that anger that's important. So if we are angry and we say something mean to somebody or call them a name, he says that's not a good way to deal with our anger. Or if we hurt somebody because we're so mad, or we hurt ourselves because we're so angry, that's not a good way to deal with anger. So, he says, as members of God's family, it's okay to be angry, but we need to deal with our anger in healthy ways so we don't hurt each other, all right? Can you think of one way to deal with anger in a healthy way? Yeah, go to a different room, calm down before you say something to hurt somebody. That's a great way. So, scream into your pillow. Exactly. Yes. Get that anger out into your pillow. All right.
And then your pillow feels bad.
And then your pillow feels bad. Yeah. All right. So the next thing he says, as members of God's family, that we are not to steal or cheat. So like stealing, not only stealing something that belongs to somebody else, like a toy or some food, but also stealing their work. So like, if you copied somebody's homework and turned it in like it was your own work, that's stealing somebody else's work and you take the credit for it and not give them credit. So as members of God's family, we are to do our own work and not steal from somebody else. All right. So the other one is words. So as members of God's family, we are to use our words to build others up, to encourage them instead of hurting them and tearing them down. All right, this is kind of a hard one. Right? Sometimes we want to say mean things to somebody, especially if they hurt us, and say mean things to us, we want to say mean words back. But as members of God's family, our words are important. And we're to use them for good. So I'm going to put the words over here. And the last one, to forgive. This one is really hard. Can you think of why to forgive might be hard?
I think it's kind of easy.
You think it's kind of easy to forgive? Okay. Well, for me, to forgive, it means that I have to sometimes ask somebody to forgive me because I did something that hurt them, and that's hard. To admit that you did something wrong. And it's also hard to forgive somebody when they hurt us. But as members of God's family, Paul says God forgave us, so we should forgive others.
You can also forgive by saying I'm sorry.
Yes, you can also forgive by saying I'm sorry. That's what we do when we say, when we ask for forgiveness. So we've got these things on the ground. And I want you to, during the sermon, I'm going to give you some paper. Paper, and if you want to just pick one or two or three and take them with you, use this paper to draw what it might look like to tell the truth, to deal with your anger in healthy ways, or to do your own work and not steal, or to use your words to build others up or to forgive. So you can pick one or a couple and either draw some pictures of what it might look like, or write some words, maybe write some encouraging words if you want to
take that one. So go ahead and pick. Which ones do you want?
Spirit of the living God, fall fresh on us today. Breathe on us the breath of life. Amen.
Amen.
For the past year, we have had a nanny take care of Dominic until he starts daycare, and she's also taking care of Tessa when she's been out of school. One morning, I was in the kitchen making breakfast for the kids when our nanny arrived. As I was cooking eggs, we started talking, and at one point in our conversation, we were talking about working out and exercising, which I do not do, but I can tell that she does because she looks like it, and because she wears exercise clothes every time that I see her. She then told me that she is a bodybuilder and she used to compete in bodybuilding competitions. And I was really amazed by this and was asking her all kinds of questions about it. And she said that she competed in 3 competitions before, and even though she no longer competes, she still works out a lot. And it shows. I mean, she doesn't look like one of those bodybuilders that you see in competitions with like the big, insane, scary looking muscles. But she definitely looks like someone who could bench press me with no problem. As we were talking, she said that she works out every single day. She's at the gym every day, exercising and lifting weights. I asked her if that ever got old, if she ever gets tired of being in the gym and working out. And she said, I don't know what I would do if I didn't work out. It had become so much a part of her life that it is just who she is. She is a person who builds up her body by working at it every day. As we heard last week, Paul describes the church as the body of Christ. Christ is the head of the body. Here, Paul continues that metaphor by calling the church at Ephesus and us to build up the body. And he says that this bodybuilding will take work. There are certain practices, actions, and exercises that we must do. Just as we heard Paul's words last week calling the church to be truth tellers, we hear it again in this part of the letter with more actions added to it. And these actions go beyond just nice things to do. They are actions to build up the body of Christ. So Paul is speaking here specifically to Christians. He isn't so much worried about non-Christians practicing these things, but it would be great if they did. He is particularly calling Christians to this communal behavior as the body of Christ. And he not only points out behaviors that build the body up, but he points out behaviors that tear the body down. First, he says we are to speak the truth to our neighbors because we are members of each other. The title of our worship series that we have been in Ephesians is called No Longer Strangers. Because we have been adopted as children of God, we are no longer strangers to each other. We are members of each other. We are members of the same body of Christ. And lying to each other tears the body apart because it breaks down trust between us. We see this breakdown of trust rippling throughout many faith traditions. With sexual abuse allegations against clergy and church leaders continuing to come to light, we hear stories of how church leaders have covered up these cases of abuse for decades. Not only has the abuse itself torn apart the body literally and figuratively, the lack of truth-telling and accountability has eroded trust within a community that should be a place of truth and trust. When that trust breaks down, the ligaments that hold us together as a body are weakened and at times torn. If we are to build up the body, we need to practice truth-telling, even when it is difficult and painful. Paul then says, be angry, but do not sin. I think it's important to know here that Paul doesn't say, do not be angry, because being angry is a sin. He recognizes that anger is a natural human emotion, and anger has a rightful place. We see throughout Scripture that God gets angry when people who are sick, vulnerable, and poor are exploited and forgotten. We see Jesus getting angry in the Jerusalem temple when he turns over the tables of the money changers because they are exploiting people who come to worship. So anger has a rightful place. But when anger is allowed to fester, when it leads to obsession over the event that led to the anger, it can cause bitterness and resentment to take root within us. That bitterness can cloud our judgment. It can impair our sense of right and wrong. It weakens our compassion. It can lead us to lash out in very harmful, destructive ways to others and to ourselves. For many years, I was the type of person who could nurse a grudge. Levi got a taste of this when we got married. If we got into an argument, or he did something to upset me or unintentionally hurt me, I could hold on to that anger for days, and I was quite adept at giving him the silent treatment. As I nursed my anger, I stewed in my self-righteous attitude that I had done nothing wrong. I was an innocent party, and he needed to be shunned until he apologized. What that anger didn't allow me to see was that there were times, yes, that he was at fault, but more times than not, I played a part in whatever happened to make me angry. I was not always the innocent party, as much as the anger wanted me to believe. It wasn't long before I realized the behavior of unbridled anger was turning me into a self-righteous, resentful person. I was always in the right, and it was everyone else's fault, in this case Levi's fault, for not doing what he was supposed to do, for not doing what was right. And I remember at one point really looking at myself and not liking the person that I saw. I realized the person that I had become by letting anger drive the ship was actually driving me and Levi apart and driving me away from my true self. That is what Paul means when he says, do not let the sun go down on your anger. This isn't something, a nice little sentiment to stitch on a pillow as a nice little proverb to look at. Sometimes it's better to talk about what you're angry about after you've had a good night's sleep and can talk about it more calmly and rationally. But the important thing here is to not let your anger lead you to tear someone apart. Paul goes on to list another practice of bodybuilding, and that is to work with our own hands instead of stealing so that we will have something to share with the needy. The significant thing here is the exercise of sharing with those in need. There are people who can't work, and people who do work who still don't make enough money. As members of the body of Christ, we have jobs not to make a big paycheck or to have a prestigious position or even to have a comfortable life. Paul reframes our behavior around work and our attitude and perception of our work. We have jobs in order to help those in need. Our work, our jobs, are to help others and benefit the community. And whether that is using the money we make from our jobs to help others, or the work that itself that we do benefits others. Or maybe it's a combination of both these things. Another practice of building up the body is forgiveness. And this is a difficult exercise, especially when there is deep hurt and pain, when there is betrayal by someone that we trust. Forgiveness is difficult. It's difficult to ask for forgiveness because that means we have to own up to our own actions that have caused harm. We have to admit that we are in the wrong. Granting forgiveness is difficult because it requires us to extend mercy in the midst of real hurt. It requires us to hold these memories of that painful event while offering forgiveness to the person that caused that painful event. It is a practice that should not be forced, manipulated, or rushed. In the book, The Gift of Forgiveness, Catherine Schwarzenegger Pratt gathers many stories of people who offer forgiveness in the face of unimaginable tragedy. One story is of Chris Williams, who forgave a teenager who was driving drunk and crashed into their car, killing his pregnant wife and two of their children. Williams says, But if he didn't offer forgiveness, he would have been locked into this never-ending cycle of anger, resentment, and seeking revenge. As Christians, we forgive not only because it frees us from cycles of anger and bitterness. We forgive because God forgives us. It is who God is. God is a God who forgives. For Christians, all of these exercises, all of these actions go beyond just moralisms, just nice things to do. For Christians, by doing these things, we build up the body to be imitators of God. This is the culmination that Paul leads to with this list of behaviors. All of these things, all of these actions that Paul lists are characteristics of God. God is truthful. God is truth. God is slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love. God continually cares for the vulnerable and those in need. God is actively at work to build up all of creation, to bring all things together in God's self. God forgives. God loves. God gives of God's self for others. That is who God is. We are called to be imitators of God. And we do this not on our own strength or our own power. We don't practice these behaviors by sheer willpower. Unlike going to the gym and working out, which largely relies on our own discipline to go to the gym, we are only able to build up the body through the work of the Holy Spirit. God has given us the gift of the Spirit that builds us up, that holds us together as a body, that enables us to live in ways that build up the body. For this reason, when we fail to practice these bodybuilding actions, Paul says that we grieve the Holy Spirit. We disappoint the Spirit because the Spirit is waiting to empower us to be bodybuilders. As followers of Christ, we have far too often shown ourselves to be a body that tears itself apart and tears others down with hateful speech and actions, bitter judgments and punishments. But that is not who we are called to be. We are children of God, called to not only love God, but to be imitators of God, our parent, to live in the world, to love in the world as God does. The more that we practice these actions, the more they become who we are. May the Spirit enable and equip us to live in love as Christ loved us and gave himself up for us. Amen.
We have the opportunity now to respond to God's gift of grace by the giving of our tithes and offerings. If you brought your offering today, you can place it in the offering plate on the table to my left after the service. You can also place your fuel offering in the can on that same table. Our fuel offering provides snacks for children in need at Kingston Springs Elementary School. If you're worshiping online, you can send a check in the mail to our church at 368 North Main Street, Kingston Springs, 37082, or give online at ksumc.org. Let's now pray over the offering. Gracious God, we thank you for the gifts that you freely give us. Help us to respond to your generosity by being people who are generous in sharing our time, talent, and resources with others. Through giving and sharing these gifts, may your Spirit build us up as your body, do you a work of love and justice in the world. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Oh, wow.
out into the world and live in love as God does. give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, God Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. You formed us in your image and breathed into us the breath of life. When we turned away and our love failed, your love remained steadfast. You delivered us from captivity, made covenant to be our sovereign God, and spoke to us through your prophets. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn.
Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory.
Hosanna in the highest.
Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord.
Hosanna in the highest.
Holy are you and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. Your Spirit anointed him to preach good news to the poor, to proclaim release to the captives and recovering of sight to the blind, to set at liberty those who are oppressed, and to announce that the time had come when you would save your people. He healed the sick, fed the hungry, and ate with sinners. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. Once we were no people, but now we are your people. When the Lord Jesus ascended, he promised to be with us always in the power of your word and Holy Spirit. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took the bread, gave thanks to you, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take, eat, all of you. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When the supper was over, he took the cup, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood, the new covenant poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as the holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ is died.
Christ is risen.
Christ will come again.
Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, so that we may be for the world the body of Christ. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world until Christ comes in final victory and we feast in his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit and your Holy Church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty God, now and forever. Amen. And now, let us pray the prayer that Jesus taught us.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses,
know that you guys are starting a new school year and the work that you do is important. So we want to bless you, send you out, commission you out as members of the body of Christ to do God's work of loving and teaching and growing others. And so, I invite you all, first of all, this is a song, actually, which I've adapted to the form of a prayer, and the lyrics are written by Carolyn Winfrey Gillett. She wrote them in 2015, and it's called God of All Learning. So if you would, just extend an arm as a symbol of our blessing and commission to our teachers and students. God of all learning, God of all knowing, we lift up these students, teachers, and school staff to you. Bless all the students gathered here and everywhere. We particularly lift up Alice and Tessa. All students, young and old, walking, driving, or riding, traveling by bus, may they remember that you go with them and that they are precious to you and to us. Some students live in poverty, some live in wealth. May we give all the tools that they need. May we make sure they're safe, loved, and healthy, so that they all may thrive and succeed. Bless all who learn and bless those who guide them. We pray especially a blessing upon Rietta, Evan, and Stefan. Bless all who teach and counsel and care. May they remember you walk beside them. Through all their school days, you, Lord, are there. Amen.
Amen.
And now I invite you to stand and receive the commission.